So what we're going to talk about is a new analysis method and presentation method on production value plus. So the overview of the session is Dini is going to introduce and talk about production value plus and how it has arisen and what we do with it. I'm just going to give a quick 2014 regional summary very quickly. Then I'm going to do the PV plus system applied to the NVT and try to give a reasonable overview of the state. And I'm going to talk a little bit about variety comparisons, be politically correct, of course, and a little bit about the new varieties that are out in the marketplace that we've been working with over the last couple of years. So we've still got Mace as our benchmark, so we're still going to try and knock that one off. So I'll bring you up to date with what's happening there. So I guess
just frozen.
Okay. All right. Well, what we might do, this is going to fly, isn't it?
Yeah. Sure.
I'm going to introduce Dini, and Dini can introduce herself and who she works for and how she got there, and perhaps just verbally explain some PV plus. For you, and hopefully we'll get into the presentation.
Hi, my name's Dini. I work for SAGI, which is the acronym for Stats for the Australian Grains Industry, a GRDC funded project that manages the statistics for the NVT among other projects. Today I'm here to introduce you to the new method of NVT results dissemination, which is called the Production Value Plus system. So a bit of background to this. The National Variety Trials exist with the remit to produce information on variety performance for farmers for their particular growing environment. And up till now, and historically as well, a lot of these production yield values for varieties across Australia are usually averaged on an ag zone basis, and so you end up with a performance value for a variety that is averaged over an ag zone, and these are the ones that are usually produced online and in the variety guides. The issue with this is that the average of all variety values over an ag zone effectively covers up the performance of the variety, and it doesn't reflect the environment impact on variety performance. So as a result of an overhaul by SAGI, we have introduced this new method called Production Value Plus system. So what are production values? Production values are essentially grain yields for each single variety at every single NVT trial in terms of tonnes per hectare. And so these are reported at a single site level for all sites in the NVT. So in the last NVT analysis, it consisted of the years 2010 to 2014, so that's 5 growing seasons worth of data. So that was a data set that consisted of 216 trials and 164 varieties. So some basic definitions of PV plus. So variety production values are either positive or negative differences relative to some kind of baseline, which is called PV0. So what PV0, the baseline, reflects is that if we were to grow all 162 varieties at this particular site, this is the expected yield or average that we would get at this particular location. Great, perfect timing. So I've just gone through that. A bit of an example, PV plus is a very graphical way of representing the NVT data. And so the PV benchmark of PV0 is just a zero line that is horizontal across. And we have the years for each growing season at a particular NVT site. So in this case, Cunderdin. And we have our 6 varieties that we want to examine the performance of over locations and time. And the production value is on the y-axis. And what we get is these deviations around the production value of zero, or the benchmark. So in the case of 2011, Cobra has a production value of 0.1 tonnes per hectare better than the trial average. And similarly in 2014, we have Kalyngri, which has a production value of negative 0.05 tonnes per hectare below the trial average. So the essential effect of production value plus system is that we can see the deviations of variety performance relative at all sites to a benchmark, which reflects that if all the varieties were grown at that site, what is the average yield, PV0? The benefit of this analysis and this method of results presentation is that we were able to actually see the long-term stability of varieties. So Kalyngery is very stable. It's always below the trial average, for example. And varieties like Korak and Mace tend to track very similarly, but are always above the trial average. To give you a bit more of a picture and an agronomic understanding of this, Peter is going to explain this with the rest of the NVT results across the ag zones.
Okay, so I'll just explain the seasons on how we went last year. If you have a look at the north in particular, it was pretty tropical up there, lacked a little bit of rain, particularly the north and the eastern areas. Certainly the eastern areas, the central area, and yeah, basically anywhere out on the further east where you went. What happened with the above average minimum temperatures, and a lot of this information Martu Pepe provided to me, there's one bloke in the world who gets around and has a good look and knows exactly what's going on in the wheat belt, it's him. So those above average temperatures really sped up variety development in the north, and we had some pretty stinking hot winds and some dry periods through that August, September, and even in July there was a bit of a dry period. So a lot of the crops up there weren't able to grab any of that late rain, a little of it there was. So if you have a look at the temperatures, now we log the temperatures at each site, and I think it would be great to have a small weather station on all of the sites to know when we get the rainfall, the intensity of it. If you have a look at this here, if that's the 30 degree line across there, Ming and Yu, if you're looking here in early August, we've had a couple of spikes up here. Now that doesn't do any good for any crops we're growing, flowering, and grain set. So you can see the north, and I'll compare it to some of the other locations around the state. That immediately, you've heard me say often that if we have a cool, dry finish, cool, wet finish, it's fantastic for yields and we do pretty well out of it. But as soon as we get belted by something like this, it's going to hurt. Now remember, with this system that we're looking at, we want to actually understand variety maturities and how they actually handle those sorts of conditions. The central, certainly the eastern area wasn't very good, but if you come back into Cunderdon and Gemmelling and 2J and all the cushy areas, they didn't do too bad. So if you have a look at Cunderdon, didn't get the heat that Ming and you got in this August period, and they got the sort of normal spikes we often experience through the September. And we also need to understand how varieties perform. They also got a bit more rainfall out here. But how varieties perform and handle that. And a regional and environmental adaptation is one of the most important things we need to get out of this information when dealing with the NVT. Southern snapshot, well, they had a lot easier run down there. It was much easier in terms of rainfall, heat, and much better cooler growing conditions. So if you have a look at South Stirlings, it's quite an unusual spot, South Stirlings. Now, all I've talked about is heat, and we all know, a lot of us have got in our mind where the heat occurred and how it affected our varieties. If you go down, have a look down south, and this is a zero line, so this is a frost line here. So we did actually pop below it or pop onto it in that particular location. So again, they're the sorts of things that information we have to know. When we're dealing with these PV Plus graphs and information, it needs to be readily accessible to each and every one of us. And I think we need to up the ante on the amount of data, information supporting data rather than more data. I think we need more information to support the data. So just to make sure the NVT is still doing the right thing, so we've got Mace, which is going fairly well at the moment, nudging 60%. If you have a look at Kalyngery, that's actually increasing. I don't know if that's actually in response to I need to grow a noodle because I can't reach protein, or whether it's I need a long season. Wildcatcham, there's certainly substitution from there up to there, as Wildcatcham will leave the system soon. Yitping, I think we've gone from frost risk management, and I'll show you later on why I think we've gone from bugger the frost risk management, I'm going to grow something that yields and makes me money, and maybe if I'm a smart person I'll save some money out of that for when I do get belted by frost. Agenda's on the way down, and Cobra and Korak are the two that are starting to make an increase. or make a bit of a bump on the horizon. So let's just talk about the varieties. Now, what we're really looking for and what I've sort of focused on in the last couple of presentations is we need stability of yield and stability of quality, in quality. So if we're going to call this our benchmark or whatever we've called a wild catching before, we've called a mace, we've called it all sorts of things. So at the moment we're using this as our benchmark, as our above and below the mean. And if you have a look at something like, I want you to concentrate on this one here, is Kalyngri, for example. Now, I've been a huge promoter of Kalyngri, saying, well, we know it, it's stable, we know what's going to happen with it each year. But unfortunately, what we're seeing with a lot of areas, it's quite stable. It's not a bad producer, but it's tending a bit too close to this line here. And if you have a look at the newer varieties, your mace and your Corax of the world, we actually have got almost the whole production line over 5 years, and we, in each of these years, you can see the level of production it's gone to, and you can basically say, well, that's a pretty good year, that wasn't, and so on. So anything that we can keep above this line here and is reasonably stable, that's what we're looking for, stability and yield and quality, then we're starting to breed some reasonable varieties that growers think, well, do I really need to go along these lines? Anything that's bobbing along the bottom here or right on the line when I've got access to varieties up here? If you have a look at something like Cobra, and I've talked about a lot in the past where we're not really chasing varieties that have an agronomic package as such. We know that Cobra will do very, very well in anywhere sort of a 2.7 plus tons, it'll do very, very well, but it hurts. It's not a good scrapper at the end of a season. It hurts when you get these dry years, and we do get them. So then, as advisors to growers, you can say, well, let's pick something that's consistent. You can have a couple of paddocks of something like Cobra, think, oh, I'm going to have a good year this year. I've got plenty of subsoil moisture. I can get it in early. I can hit the sowing windows. Then I'll have a go at something else. But something like, let's say, for example, Kalyngri, then maybe we've got better genetics now, but it's worthwhile having a look at some new material. And Buntine. So, and again, this is why the NBT has to be the best it is every single year, because this particular instance here, I'd blame that on Kalyx, I think, because we sowed that on the 27th of May, and I think most growers had finished at that particular in that area, and then not only that, we wore a pretty harsh end of the season. So, and all that does is just takes out the genetics, and the environment is a limiting factor. So we can't really tell too much, and you can't make recommendations on what variety you're going to get out of that cluster. But back here you can. We've got some pretty reasonable yields all the way through, and you can start to pick. You can see the trends there still, and still the same behaviour of these varieties. Likes a good season. There's a good season. Likes a good season. We missed it in 2012, of course, but you can see what happens when it gets a bit of a harsh one. Okay, Cunderdon, it's a great place to farm, nice long-term traditional yields, and you can see again, there are big Kalyngri growers out there, but there's improvements in genetics above the line, which is worthwhile looking at. So I just want to show you a few of the different areas. So Mucka, we've been out there for many years on the same property, it's a heavy land site. This year, it was sown at the right time, you can see we really struggled. And if you look at growers out there who've got two chances in five to make the bucks up, where they below break even and money lost, they've got two cracks at it to get back those the bad years. So you're not going to go and pick something like this that's sitting below the line here. You need something that's going to perform in their environment on a consistent basis. And you can start to deliver that by looking at some of this material here. Some farmers have got way too much time on their hands. Wagen, again, it's a reasonable producing area, and it's a lot further south and a lot more prone to frosts and so on. But if you have a look at this here, we again have got a consistent performer above the line. And now we get down to Yippie country. And the reason we've all been growing Yippie, Darren, you've been recommending Yippie for years. It's the best frost tolerant or resistant or best frost risk management, mitigation. Am I using all the right words?
But you see it's actually performing consistently below the line. And it's what, 1999, I think it was? Is that right, Steve? I think that when it came out. Narrambeen, so I want to go from Wagen. Let's go right out east. It's harder to go further east. I think Rich has got one somewhere out of Moorine Rock. That's furthest east we've got. Again, reasonably consistent yields for an area right out there. And you can see the material, the maturity material that we're looking for. And again, you've got Kalyngri, so bang in a reasonable year. This is the sort of thing that's really difficult to explain and why I think the data we get and collect and put in the information box to go with the site is, you know, exactly why did it do that in a reasonable sort of a year? There's quite a dip there from a poorer year. So they're all the sorts of things that need explaining further or an effort to explain further. So this is the Esperance region. It's a godlike country down there. And the South Stirlings, again, it's very, very, you know, it's quite high yielding area. And, you know, you're losing out if you keep growing something like Yitpi when we do have access to material here. You've got your Hydras, you've got your Cobras, and you've got your Trojans of the world, all sitting reasonably above the line in this sort of a zone here. So it's material that we haven't got a lot of, seen a lot of, but it's showing a reasonable amount of potential. So you can, you know, start banging those out a few more years there, around the post there. We'll start to get a bit better stories out here. So the NBT is just verification of how you're going to present information and talk to your growers and what varieties they need to be growing or could potentially grow. I did these regressions, Youngie did them a couple of years ago, Mato gave me some data this year, and so we need to know that we're actually trying to get this is only 2 years of data, so it's 86 trials, 13 and 14, so it's only two seasons, but it's an average of all of those trials through there in line of best fit. So what we need, if we're going to actually replace a variety, you need to know a little bit about, well, is it going to be one for one? Because remember last year I showed you, well, Korak and Mace are basically one for one, and Kalyngri and Fortune, dead ringers, one for one. There's nothing in it, so why would you move? So we just want to see where these things pick up. So Hydra, like Cobra, tends to perform a bit better in the three-ton area, so it's no good looking at a big change if you're in this yield zone here, three less. But it might be worth having a crack, but remember there's a lot less data points up here and you don't get to that that often. Trojan versus Yitpi. Now, this is one of the areas that breeders, in response to market signals, is I need a long season. I need something to do, use for frost risk management in the southern areas, south of Great Eastern Highway. So Longreach's variety Trojan is showing some increase over Yitpi, and you saw Yitpi sitting below that the average line. Well, there is some more improved genetics. Now, sure, there's some agronomic issues around all the new varieties that come through, and I won't be able to tell you about them all. So Zen versus Kalyngri. This has been, I said Fortune and Kalyngri have been one-to-one for years, and I've stated and stayed with that forever, and that's why you never ever saw Fortune come through. But I did come across growers that said, nah, Fortune is absolutely fantastic. Well, it probably is, because, it performs the same as Kalyngri in their little environment. So that's fine if that's the decision. But Zen, which is new improved material, is looking like it might get away from, and you've got to remember this is little bits. This is not as though, I'm not talking about this is absolutely fantastic, let's rip into Zen because it's going to be so much better. But it is showing an indication that it is better than Kalyngri. So just in summary, always like these shows because I can show my holiday pics. So Mace still remains king of the jungle for now, and everybody is desperately trying to knock it off, as I said before. Korak complements Mace, but knows its place. So if you're recommending, you'll see the one-for-one lines, and Korak and Mace are on it, but you wouldn't dare push Korak close to the coast, for example, because black point issues. Push it out east and its ability to handle terminal drought. There's all the sorts of information you've got to keep gleaning. You've got to speak to Dion, you've got to speak to Jason, you've got to speak to everybody you possibly can to suck in as much information as you can. Don't listen to just me. So the emerging varieties we've got, Zen, which was the old 6046, and I did talk a lot about it at NBT presentations. And so again, using Wild Catchem as a base and Kalyngri, so two good crosses there. Supreme 6042, I guess the big thing to that is it's very expressive dwarf gene. That is one of the shortest varieties I've seen for a while. But the beauty of it is, no matter how dry it gets, it'll be short. If it's really, really wet, it'll be short. So that's probably one of the downsides of it, and it's very much an Arano derivative. So Hydra, so you've got a Bonnie Rock Strezlecki. So I don't know much about breeding, but I don't know why I would pick those two, but Hydra seems to be doing, you know, it's sparking up. It's up there in amongst the top performers. But it's interesting, it's good to see, you know, you've got good quality issues here and disease here, and I don't know where else everything came from. Impress Seal Plus. Now, remember the 3526 that I talked about in MVTs? It's, I believe, the first of the IMIs that's got some pretty good potential, yield potential. However, if it's a longer season, like mainly in the north though, it wouldn't go too many places else. It's just an absolute wild catch-em type, and pretty reasonable disease package, really, really good foliar disease package. But in a longer season, that's where it probably fades away compared to something like Justica, for example. So the other varieties, which we talked about last year, is Harper, Trojan, and Cobra. So they're your long Harper and Trojan, the longer season. Their phenology is still different to Yitpi, it's not the same. So that's agronomically we've got to sort out over time. And Bremer, Waggett 328, has just been released, and we'll just keep that down on the south coast, apparently. This is where it's headed for, Ag Zone 6 and the bottom of Ag Zone 5. Good sprouting tolerance, I think, is where it's been leveraged for. So, recognition and thanks to the following. So, thanks to the grower cooperators. Without you guys, we wouldn't be able to do this. Grower group staff, we work closely with. Ulmo and Kalyx staff, who really put this presentation together for me. And Dini and PV Plus, you'll hear a lot more of that soon. Martu for lending me a couple of his slides, which was great. And GRDC, ACAS, and that's it.